Further, the living substance is being, which is in truth subject, or what is the same is in truth actual only insofar as it is the movement of positing itself or is the mediation of itself othering with itself. This substance is, as subject, pure, simple negativity, and is for this very reason the bifurcation of the simple. It is the doubling which sets up opposition, and then again the negation of this indifferent diversity and of its antithesis, the immediate simplicity. Only this self-restoring sameness, or this reflection in otherness within itself, not an original or immediate unity as such, is the true. It is the process of its own becoming, the circle that presupposes its end as its goal, having its end also as its beginning, and only by being worked out to its end is it actual. In section 17, as we've seen, Hegel insisted that we need to understand substance, and by this we're going to see he means the substance, as subject, as not being something inert, but rather as being something active, something dynamic. And then the question is, well, what does that really mean? How does this work? And that's what section 18 is leading us into. You see I've got a sort of schema up here on the board with a number of Hegel's terms. Before we go into that, what is this section completely focused on? The question of truth. What is the truth of a substance, or of substance itself, of the substance? Truth is not going to be what he calls a primal or original or simple unity. That doesn't mean that it's going to lack unity altogether, but what it means is we need to rethink what unity, what actually being one thing, means. And here we're grappling with terms that are quite difficult. They may seem to be very simple to you until you start thinking about them. They're sort of like Augustine when he talks about, before somebody asks me what time is, I know perfectly well what it is. As soon as somebody asks me about it, now I'm not quite so sure. It becomes murkier and murkier upon analysis. It works the same way with terms like truth or unity. These are actually what in medieval theology and philosophy they called the transcendentals. And Hegel is grappling with these sorts of things. What is the truth? What is the true? What is truth per se? What is unity? What is being? What is goodness? And there's proposals to have other things as transcendentals. That's a whole different conversation. But I think that's important to bring up here at the start. So Hegel says the truth of substance is that it's also a subject. And what does that really mean? That means that it exists, or it has its being in it, what he calls positing, setting forth. This is what we call a thesis. Setting forth itself, that is to say that it's actively pushing itself out into reality. It's not just something sitting there inert. So he says, it is in truth actual only insofar it is the movement of positing itself, or is the, here he brings up another term, mediation of itself othering with itself. So what that means is that for a subject or a substance, whichever way we want to look at it, the way it puts itself forward is as itself, and yet at the same time as something other than itself, as something different from itself. And you might say, what is it, like splitting into two? In a certain way it is, and we'll talk about that. But this is a splitting in two that takes place within the thing itself, within its own movement. It becomes other to itself, and only by doing so can it actually be fully what it is supposed to be. Only in this way does it have the possibility of dynamism, of activity, of, if we want to look ahead to a few other paragraphs that are coming up, of purposive activity, of rationality. All of these things for Hegel require that it undergo what he calls mediation. In German, this is Vermittlung. So when you see this term media, think middle. Also think, as we're going to see in another very important paragraph later on, also think the medium in which something takes place. But think middle term, like the middle term of an argument or syllogism as well. Think about what it was that was originally intended to do, which is to connect up two things which are not the same and bring them into relation to each other. Mediation is going to be a key concept for Hegel, and going ahead a few paragraphs, we're going to look at that in a bit more detail. Here he's just sort of naming it, introducing it. So he says, the substance is as subject. So if we're talking about this kind of being, this mode of being, as subject, he says, it is pure simple negativity. Now, there's nothing simple about this negativity, because what does it mean to negate? It means to say no. It means to say there's something else. It means to say not that. So already there is othering or alterity involved in negation. And so it puts itself forward, and yet at the same time also negates itself without losing itself, without just vanishing, without disappearing. So it's doing two things at the same time. It's becoming complex. So he says, it is for this very reason the bifurcation of the simple. What's simple splits. And, you know, if we want to use a very simple schema here, I understand simple is a little bit of a pun. You've got what's being posited, and then you have what is being put forth as no, as something other, as something else, which is a negation of that. That's why he talks in terms of antithesis here. So he says, it's the doubling which sets up opposition, and then again, the negation of this indifferent diversity and its antithesis. Now what he means by antithesis there is you have a positing, so a thesis, then you have something else, and then you have the antithesis between them. So perhaps I should put this on the board, because a lot of times people get this idea that Hegel is all about this triadic structure that's the same in every case, where you have thesis, antithesis, synthesis, and that these are always identifiable. So we have our subject, substance, and we have positing or thesis. And at the same time, we have the negation of that. We have the other, which is also being put forward at the same time as what this substance is. These are different from each other. Now, between these, we have an antithesis. We have a being set at odds with each other. That's literally what antithesis means. So what is going on here? The subject is also, at the same time, overcoming that very antithesis of saying, yeah, you just have these two things that are sort of arbitrarily connected with each other, and they're different, and that's it. And it's saying, no, the difference here really matters. This is something that has to be explored, something that has to be worked out. And so he goes on and he says, only the self-restoring sameness, this entire process, self-restoring sameness. This is where, if you want to, you know, bring up Hegelian terms, you could say synthesis is actually taking place. Only this is the true. The true is not something simple. The true is something that is complex. That means it's not just composed of a bunch of simples, you know, into some sort of complex, but rather is the relation between all of these moments within this process. That is what truth is. So he says it's the process of its own becoming, the circle that presupposes its end as its goal, having as its end also as its beginning, and only by being worked out fully does it become fully actual. Now, that's where the paragraph ends. I think one of the things that you want to keep in mind as you're reading through this is that terms like actual, like true, have a certain kind of relativity to them. Not a relativism, but a certain kind of relativity to what stage in the process we're currently looking at each phase in the phenomenology. So when he says that only by going through this process of reintegration does truth really become actual, he's not saying that there's no actuality before that, no reality, no Wirklichkeit. He is saying that you have something new, something greater, something that's more true, something that's more actual coming on the scene. And it's not something that was totally new in the sense of not being there at all. It just wasn't worked out fully. Thus, the life of God and divine cognition may well be spoken as a disporting of love with itself. But this idea sinks into mere edification, and even insipidity, if it lacks the seriousness, the suffering, the patience, and the labor of the negative. In itself, that life is indeed one of untroubled equality and unity with itself, for which otherness and alienation and the overcoming of alienation are not serious matters. But this in itself an abstract universality, in which the nature of the divine life to be for itself, and so to the self-movement of the form, are altogether left out of account. If the form is declared to be the same as the essence, then it is, ipso facto, a mistake to suppose that cognition can be satisfied with the in itself or the essence, but can get along without the form, that the absolute principle or absolute intuition makes the working out of the former or the development of the latter superfluous. Just because the form is as essential to the essence as the essence is to itself, the divine essence is not to be conceived and expressed merely as essence, that is, as immediate substance or pure self-contemplation of the divine, but likewise as the form, and in the whole wealth of the developed form. Only then is it conceived and expressed as an actuality. Paragraph 19 is another one of those famous passages that contains what you might call a Hegelian catchphrase, that is the discussion of the seriousness, the suffering, the patience, and the labor of the negative. What's all that about? So he starts off by saying that the life of God, so we're talking about the divine substance, that which is most real, the life of God, divine cognition, the process of God thinking, God coming to know things, can be understood as love disporting with itself, a play of love with itself. We call it love squared. And he says, that's not a bad idea. That's not a bad conception for understanding what I'm talking about. But it's going to sink into mere edification. You remember edification is always a bad thing for Hegel. And even being insipid, being tasteless, actually lacking wisdom too, because there's, you know, if you look at the Latinate connection, if it lacks the seriousness, the suffering, the patience, and the labor of the negative. Now those are not things that you would normally attribute to the divine, except for maybe the seriousness, the suffering, the patience, the labor. God is, you know, completely omnipotent, if we're thinking about, you know, traditional Jewish Christian, Muslim conceptions of God. So why would God have to suffer? Why would God have to labor? Now with Christianity it gets a little bit different, right? And you have people engaging in reflections of why God became man, like St. Anselm. I'm going to set that aside for the moment. Why is negativity important? So Hegel talks about the in itself. In itself, God, or the divine substance that's also subject, is rather static. Everything is just fine. It's just sort of like a picture play, you might say. It says, lacking this negative, that life is one of untroubled equality and unity with itself. It's got this sort of relation to itself that just repeats over and over again. Nothing changes. It's all just great. But what's really needed is an engagement with otherness and alienation. Now, this, the very notion that this is on the scene shows you that this can't be the whole show. Otherness, this becoming other that we saw in the last paragraph, going beyond that, alienation. Alienation means becoming other to oneself, realizing that one is not what one thought one is, that one is, you know, anguishedly split over things. You know, we saw this talked about a little bit earlier with those passages about the new age that we're in, where spirit has come to realize that it's lost touch with itself. If all you have is this play of love or God or knowledge or whatever it is with itself over and over again, then this stuff doesn't really matter. But the fact that this is actually there at all means that it does matter. And that over here we're kind of hiding from reality, hiding from ourselves. And really what has to happen is this movement of self-othering, of reflection into self, of splitting, of alienation. And then there has to be, only on that basis, can there be, an overcoming, a sublation, a sublimation of this alienation. Only after you've actually acknowledged it, you know, think about any given problem, only after you acknowledge that there's a real problem there can you actually grapple with the problem. Can you actually see it for what it is? Can you actually feel its weight and start to sound its depths? So he says, this in itself is abstract. That's the problem. It's abstract universality. But the nature of the divine is to be for itself. The nature of any subject, of anything that actually thinks, anything that knows, that takes a position, is, well, at least at a certain level of reflexivity, is to be for itself, to be able to take a position on itself. And in doing so, beings often find out that they aren't what they thought they were in the first place, that there is otherness, there is alienation taking place, that expectations are not met and have to be, you know, rethought, and then there has to be a process of reworking this. So he talks about this as the nature of divine life, because think about it, if it's God, if it's the absolute really needs to be everything that it can be. So the self-movement of the form gets left out of account. Now, why does this matter? Well, Hegel is going to talk about something else at this point. He's going to leave this notion of form on the table, so to speak, and he's going to explore the relationship between form and essence. Normally, let me start with essence. Normally, when we think about the essence of a thing, we think about what it is that makes that thing that thing. And we have a tendency to think of essences as sort of static conceptions that we can grasp, and then, you know, we've got some sort of copy of that in our head, or, you know, there may be other relations in which we think about our knowledge of it. But we grasp the essence. If we're really lucky, we can actually come up with a definition that expresses the essence. And that definition better not change over time, better stay the same. And the essence better stay the same over time. Hegel is actually critiquing that very notion. He's not just saying, too, by the way, well, why can't it change over time? He's actually saying it does change. There is a process involved. So he'll actually talk about what's essential to the essence. this may throw you. You can say, well, essence isn't the sort of thing which can actually be squared, which can be taken to a higher power. But why not? If we're doing metaphysics, we can actually say, okay, you've got essences out there. What's actually essential to essences or to the notion or, you know, the being of essence itself? What's essential to that? And for Hegel, the answer is actually that it has a form, that it is dynamic, that it is developing, that it has a history, that it has a before and after, that it has a process of becoming other and then recovery of that. So he says, if the form is declared to be the same as the essence, then it's a mistake by that very nature to suppose that cognition can be satisfied with the in itself or the essence. What we want is not just some sort of, you know, static, stay the same anchor point. We want to know how that essence actually plays out. Think about a conception like freedom. Now, you can come up with a definition of freedom, and even if you get other people to accept that definition, you need to actually have examples. You need to be able to talk about the development of freedom in time, in history, in situations, for it to really make sense, for one to say, yes, you have grasped the essence of it. The essence is not a verbal formula for Hegel. So he says that thought can't really be happy with the in itself or the essence, but getting along without the form. The absolute principle or absolute intuition makes the working out of this integral to the very process. So if we're talking about divine cognition, not just human cognition, but divine cognition, it's going to incorporate this process, this circular, actually cyclonal process, of getting closer and closer and closer to what's really essential. Stripping things away, adding things in, incorporating things. That's the process of the dialectic. That's what he's describing here. So he says, only then, when we actually think of things in terms of the wealth of form, only then is the absolute conceived and expressed as an actuality. Now, he is talking about things other than the absolute, because those are all parts for Hegel of the absolute. They're all moments within the absolute. But he's also talking about the entirety, the whole. So he's carrying out a kind of logical analysis here. The true is the whole, but the whole is nothing other than the essence consummating itself through its development. Of the absolute, it must be said that it is essentially a result, that only in the end is it what it truly is, and that precisely in this consists its nature, that is, to be actual, subject, the spontaneous becoming of itself. Though it may seem contradictory that the absolute should be conceived essentially as a result, it needs little pondering to set this show of contradiction in its true light. The beginning, the principle, or the absolute, is at first immediately enunciated, it is only the universal. Just as when I say all animals, this expression cannot pass for a zoology, so it is equally plain that the words the divine, the absolute, the eternal, etc., do not express what is contained in them, and only such words, in fact, do express the intuition as something immediate. Whatever is more than such a word, even the transition to a mere proposition, contains a becoming other that has to be taken back or as a mediation. But it is just this that is rejected with horror, as if absolute cognition were being surrendered, when more is made of mediation than in simply saying that it is nothing absolute and is completely absent in the absolute. Paragraph 20 is one of these where he's drawing some threads together and tying them in a knot and getting us ready to move on to some new ideas. So he talks about the true, and he says the true is the whole. And then we want to ask, well, what the hell does that mean? The true is the whole. It's one thing to talk in terms of like, well, you know, you got to grasp things holistically and take everything in. for Hegel, it's not just going to be, well, you know, you don't want to leave anything out. It's rather, when we ask this question, how is the truth the whole? It's a question of essence, as he says, consummating itself through development. Now, I wrote a couple other words under this consummating because I want us to think in terms of a few other related concepts that are connected with this, both in Hegel's thought and also in more, you know, the tradition that he's working off of. To talk about something consummating itself, particularly to talk about an essence consummating itself, what does that mean? You know, I've brought this up in other places. Aristotle in the Politics talks about the phusis, the nature of a thing, and he says, well, the nature of a thing is what that thing is when it's fully developed, when it's fully unfolded, when it's been brought to its perfection. And this is very similar to what Hegel's talking about. So a human being, for example, or a horse is less complex than a human being because it's not a rational animal, and reason doesn't, you know, make things simpler. It actually, like, complicates the hell out of things, including what kind of beings we are, because only rational beings actually ask, what kind of being am I? What is my essence? That's something that has to be worked out, that has to be, and these emphasize different sort of aspects of it, unfolded. When you unfold something, you're pulling something out of it. You're finding the recesses of it and bringing them to light. So that sort of puts the stress on the activity there. The perfecting. What is the goal? What is the end? What is the you know, finished state that we're talking about here, that the things tend towards through their processes of development, provided the development is going the right way? That's what we're focused on here. That's how the true is the whole, because the whole ends up being consummated through this very complex process of development that's going to take place through all of human history, all of human culture, coming to a culmination in, of course, Hegel. We might want to, you know, say he might have been a little optimistic about that. But let's see where he's going. So he says, the nature of the absolute is to be actual, to be subject, that to be the spontaneous becoming of itself. And he says, it may seem contradictory that the absolute should be conceived as a result rather than being just the starting point. But the absolute is something that actually has to develop over time. And now he's going to make an analogy here, a really interesting one, and he's going to make a number of different analogies that lead us into some you might call actually logical exercises that show us what we're supposed to be grasping here. So he says, when I say all animals, this doesn't pass for a zoology. Similarly, when I use words like the divine, the absolute, the eternal, they don't actually express what's contained in them. We have to unfold or unpack what's actually in those. It's not evident from the start what exactly they comprise, and our initial ideas about it may turn out, and generally in Hegel's case, do turn out to be mistaken, turn out to be starting points that we have to surpass and surpass and surpass, and also sort of bring along with us. So he says, whatever is more than such a word, even the transition to a mere proposition, contains a becoming other. So as soon as we start saying something like the absolute, you know, we can pick predicates that we want to say of it. What does the absolute mean? The absolute, let's say we say, develops. Here we have a subject, here we have a predicate. Already this term develops is starting to sort of color our notion of the absolute. We now have additional information. Now you could say, well, you know, the whole idea of develops was contained in the absolute, if you could see that from the start. Just like, you know, Thomas Aquinas said, you know, if you really understand what the term God means, you'll see that necessary being is already sort of packed in there. He says this, by the way, in the commentary on the Psalms. Hegel would say, look, when you're doing that, the predicate is modifying the way in which you see the subject. It's actually making it more concrete, more rich. It's no longer just this abstract thing. So he says, what's going on here is the process of becoming other. The predicate mediates the subject. The subject mediates the predicate. They actually develop. The development develops. And then he says, a lot of people don't like that. He says, this is a mediation. And he says, it's just this that is rejected with horror, as if absolute cognition were being surrendered whenever more is made of mediation than simply saying it's nothing absolute and completely absent in the absolute. Mediation is going to be integrally present, unavoidable, in the very, not just concept, but the very reality of the absolute. And its process of development is going to take place through a number of different mediations.